All right, hello everybody. This is my name is Adrian Bednarek, and this session is it covers two of my favorite topics: exploiting and massively multiplayer online RPGs. It's a mouthful, so I call them online games or just games or whatever. So the obligatory, who is this guy right here? I'm a security analyst and researcher at ISE. I specialize in application layer, reverse engineering, and protocol analysis. I started in the field as a mostly ethical black hat. That's an oxymoron, I know. But back in the day, my first hack was in a game called Ultima Online back in 1997. I was back in college then. And basically, I created a side channel to create in-app purchase functionality before in-app purchase functionality was a thing. I know that's a hipster thing to say, but that's kind of the way it went. So what I do is, back in the day, I reverse engineered Ultima Online, and I found a bunch of exploits in their protocol. I was able to do things that weren't intended. Ultima Online had persistent housing, so housing was in high demand and a scarce commodity or a scarce resource. So I found a way to delete other players' houses. I saw that on eBay, like small homes, like a 10 by 10 house was selling for about, you know, $100 to $150 a pop. So I was like, nobody's ever sold a castle. So I deleted a bunch of houses, like I cleared a whole field full of houses, just deleted them all. And I placed the castle there and I put it up on eBay. I was expecting to make, you know, maybe $300-$400. So I was watching the auction as it ended, like an hour before, and it went into a bidding war. The price just started going up and up and up, and it ended up selling for like $1,900 to some like airline pilot out of Alaska. It was kind of interesting, and we went through an escrow service back then, and the escrow service typically dealt with collectibles and high value items like art or whatever. And when we told them this escrow transaction was for a castle inside of a game, they thought we were pranking them because, you know, nobody understood gaming and how things worked in virtual commodities then. So it was an interesting opportunity and an interesting process, but we got through it. I've been exploiting games for over 20 years now, and I work with my business partner. We both work in tandem. But we both discovered probably around 200 ODAs in online games. I'll attribute 100 of that to myself. It's kind of a, when we open up the protocol and start hacking the game, it's kind of like a race to see who can find the first thing. It's kind of an interesting process. And we're going to talk about common exploits in online games. There's a lot of them. I noticed that each game typically has anywhere from 5 to 10 exploits that will either give you such a major advantage for your character that you'll basically break the gameplay for everybody else, or you'll completely subvert the economy, or if the game is using an in-app purchase business model, you have the ability to basically destroy that. I mean, we'll talk a little bit about that later. And we'll talk about some tools and methods and challenges. You do need to create custom tools. You need to be creative in how you do these things. And there's a lot of challenges. Initially, when games first came out back in the early 2000s, they really didn't employ any countermeasures or protections on their client. You could just go in with a simple debugger and start fiddling with packets or the functionality of the client. Later, and especially now, they do a lot of crazy things, like they obfuscate the code flows in the client, they use self-modifying code, they use third-party obfuscation mechanisms, and they do a lot of things to protect the protocol, and we'll talk a little bit about that later. So for those of you who don't know, what is an MMORPG? It's typically, think of it as a single virtual world where thousands of players can interact with each other. And these interactions are typically, you know, you can watch each other move around and navigate through the world. You can chat with them. You can go out and kill bad guys with them in a party. You can collect loot, you can trade loot between players, and you can also sell items in-game on like a virtual auction house. It's like an eBay inside of a game. They typically call it an auction house, and it's where you can like offload any extra loot you have and you want to sell it for extra coin. Typically, online games used to be Windows-based, and that's changing a lot now with a lot of them going to iOS and Android. I forgot the name of it, but I think Lineage Go is a huge one right now. I think it's on both iOS and Android. So this is a screenshot of what an MMORPG looks like. This is a party of four people exploring a dungeon, about to kill a bad guy. Nothing too complicated there. So let's talk about, yeah, I'm a big fan of South Park, so there's a few South Park references here. So let's talk about just a high overview of the client-server game architecture. You could think of it as, you could think of the game client as a web browser, but it's specifically designed to display 3D graphics and be multimedia intensive. So typically you have your game client that processes user input. This user input is translated to the client, like if the user typed in a chat message or if the user clicked on another user to select another user, the client handles all of this. Then it typically fires off a sends data routine with this event. And this routine typically encrypts the event and sends it out to the network. So this goes out to the game server, and the game server does everything in reverse. It receives the data, decrypts it, and processes it. So for example, if we were talking about moving inside of a game, the game client would say, hey, I moved north, this many units. This would get sent to the game server. The game server would notify anybody else in the vicinity to all the other players that you took a step forward or whatever. So it's pretty straightforward. Let's talk a little about demographics. MMORPGs are played by pretty much everybody across the board. Everybody's into them. There's really no age group that stands out. I'm surprised that the 12 to 17 group is so low. I'd expect that to be the dominating group in playing online games. But it looks like it's people in between their 20s and 30s. This one is not too surprising. How many hours per week do most people play? And typically it looks like most people play between 10 and 20 hours per week, with a third of the sample. The outliers out here, 1.6% of players playing more than 60 hours a week. Those are probably your Chinese farmers or people playing the games for a living. MMORPGs are very popular. There's lots of stats about this, but I think the gold standard is WoW. WoW gets looked at really closely, and when World of Warcraft first came out, it quickly jumped up to a player base of 5 million sometime late 2005. Then it went up to around 10 to 12 million, and it kind of held steady there for a few years. And then it started dropping off. This drop off is probably due to other games entering the marketplace and a lot of people just moving to playing these online games on their mobile phones and mobile devices. I think WoW is hovering around 5 million players right now, maybe a little lower. So how does the business model work? How do these game companies make their money? In the early days, it was purely a subscription model. You go into a store, you buy a box. In this box, there's a code. So you go online, sign up, punch in this code, and typically you're allowed access to the game, and it includes 30 days of playtime. So you can play the game for 30 days. After that 30 days expires, you're locked out of the server and you're prompted to open up a subscription account. And continue paying, it's typically around $15 per month to continue playing the game. So World of Warcraft, when it first started out, and I think still is, purely subscription-based. And you can imagine with 10 million players paying $15 a month, they're making pretty good money. And it's unrestricted, unlimited gameplay, there's no gameplay caps. China had a problem with players playing too much, and they tried to impose laws restricting players from playing more than a certain number of hours a week, because a lot of them were gold farming. Those were the players playing more than 60 hours a week, and there were cases of people just passing out and dying as they were playing online games and trying to make some money in them. So the subscription model isn't really used very much these days. We moved to the in-app purchase business model, where typically you get the game for free or you pay a really small fee to gain access to it. And then, you know, as you're playing this game for free, typically you're prompted to purchase items that enhance your gameplay. In multiplayer games, a lot of people complain that it's a pay-to-win business model where the player that pays the most is the king of the hill. So it's unfair to the people that don't want to spend the money. They're like, hey, we can't compete with this guy that's, you know, spending $5,000 a month to upgrade his character to the best possible stats on every time some new items come out in the in-app purchase store. So now a lot of game companies are just selling cosmetic items. If you're playing FPS games, weapon skins are a huge thing, or just silly hats for your characters so you can show off, you know, you bought a hat for like $20 or whatever, and it's super epic, whatever. Some people are into that. I've also noticed that a lot of mobile games use a time limit. Like, you can play the game for free, and you, if it's a puzzle game, you have a certain number of moves. Once those moves are used up, it'll prompt you to pay a few bucks to continue playing. Or it'll tell you to wait 24 hours, you know, you can start playing again tomorrow, or you can pay like $1 and you can start playing now. So my wife plays one of these puzzle games where, you know, she plays for like an hour and says, oh, hey, all of your moves have been used up. Pay now or wait till tomorrow to continue playing. So I went into the phone settings and I changed the date forward one day, and I opened up the app again and it allowed her to play. And this is like a common exploit in time-based limit games where they don't really validate how the integrity of the clock on the phone. So you can just forward the clock and bypass any time limits in a lot of these time limit games. All right, so here's another South Park reference. It was one of my favorite episodes. It's called Freemium Isn't Free. And they basically made fun of the in-app purchase business model. And they specifically used online role-playing games as an example. So they described that players like to explore the content in the game. They like to collect items, kill monsters and bad guys, and collect your loot. They like to spend this money in-game and buy better items to improve their character and stats so they can go explore more content and harder content. And this is like a never-ending cycle. So in South Park, they propose that you can monetize every single step of this gameplay loop. DLCs are popular. Loot boxes are a popular item now under legal scrutiny. A lot of governments are saying that loot boxes are no different than gambling. So especially in European countries, they're under a lot of trouble there. So anywhere game companies see that a player has a demand for an item or a functionality, they're able to monetize on that. So the argument was that games now are just barely any fun, and you have to do an in-app purchase or a microtransaction to make it more fun. So paying for virtual goods, that's crazy talk. Why not just hack it, right? How hard could it be? But first, let's talk about integer overflows. It's one of my favorite exploits. It's the most common one. I haven't seen a game or a system that used financial transactions that wasn't susceptible to integer overflows. Integer overflows are, think of it as your car's odometer. Like once you hit 99,000 miles, 999, and you drive one more mile, it rolls over to zero. If you're able, well, if it worked in a way where if you drive backwards, you subtract a mile, It doesn't work that way. But if you were sitting at zero and you subtracted the mile, it would roll back to 9,999. In computing, the same concept applies, because if you're using a variable to store the amount of money a player has, if it's a 32-bit variable, it can only hold so much data before there's an integer overflow event. I think it's like 4.2 billion or whatever. Right, so here's kind of what an integer overflow looks like in assembly land. I know it's not the best time at 9:30 in the morning to talk about assembly and integer overflows, but it's just three quick little slides. So here in, we move to a register EAX, the maximum integer 32 value, which is represented as all Fs in hexadecimal. If you were to translate this to human speak, this would be about $4.2 billion. So we load EAX with the maximum in 32. So this line we're on, we're going to add one to it. We're going to cause an overflow event. And you'll see that we were at the maximum value and EAX returned back to zero. There was an overflow event. There's a misconception that overflowing registers and values will cause a runtime exception. It's a totally silent process. That's why it's so pervasive in financial systems. It really doesn't show up during QA and testing because it's not really tested well. But it really doesn't, it's a silent exploit that is really hard to catch. One thing I'll show you guys is that, if you notice here, there's an eFlags register. An eFlags register is kind of like the state of the processor. And there's a flag called the carry flag. And when you have an overflow event, the carry flag will get set. So that's, at the CPU level, that's one of the best ways to test if an overflow event happened. If you have an underflow event, then the overflow flag will get set. It's really easy to test, and depending on what language you're using, you should, if you're a developer or if you're in contact with developers, they should be familiar with how integer overflow and underflow events are handled in their particular language. So let's look at an integer overflow in the wild. I'll use WildStar Online to demonstrate this. So this is WildStar Online. It came out, I think, in 2013. They spent about $50 million developing this game. Had a pretty big budget. So on WildStar Online, it's like any other game. The unique thing about this game is you had a commodities exchange, which is basically an auction house where you could place orders to buy items. Like, let's say if you wanted to buy iron ore, you'd go to the commodities exchange and say, hey, I'll buy 10 iron ore and I'm willing to pay, you know, 10 gold for it or whatever. It'll create an order. When somebody fills that order, you'll get the items in your mail. So I'm going to exploit the marketplace functionality with an integer overflow to do something interesting. I know the guys in the back, you probably can't see, but the important thing to know is that down here at the bottom right now, I have 130 platinum. Soon we'll see that change a little bit. So right now I'm just creating a buy order to learn how, and I'm using a simple debugger. There's nothing fancy going on here. So I'm creating a buy order and I'm just kind of learning how it works. I'm just kind of giving it false data to see if anything happens. Next time around, I'll do a buy order for the maximum. This is an integer 64 value, so it's a 32-bit client, but it's an N64 value, so it's using two stack positions. And my buy order will be for the maximum unsigned 64-bit value, which is about 9 quintillion. Again, notice down here on the bottom right that right now I have 130 platinum, and that's about to change as soon as I commit this transaction. All right. Yeah. Yeah, now I have so much money that the client can't display it, which is problematic. Because once you have so much money, you don't really want to keep it on your character because it'll end up getting flagged and you'll get your account banned. So right now I have so much money that I have a problem. Like, I need to get rid of it before I get banned. But as you can see, my order came through for an item in game, and I'm willing to pay like 9 quintillion platinum for this order. So the game added a fee to my order, and then it caused my character's money amount to roll over, basically. So again, to recap, I submitted a max signed N64 value of 7F all down the line. The server adds a small fee, and it rolls me over into negative territory. When you subtract a negative number from a negative, you get a positive. So if you subtract 5 minus negative 8, you get 13. And this is essentially what happened here. So I was able to find like a debug statement in the game where I could type in a special command in chat and it would spit out exactly how much I have. And you can see up here, the system went totally haywire. It said I received like negative 200 billion platinum. I have no idea what that's about, but you know, I ended up with like 9.0 quintillion gold. And we'll talk about the implications later, because WildStar Online does have an in-app purchase business model, kind of. So who are the malicious actors when they're hacking online games? Let's talk about motivation. A lot of them do it for the lulz. I think it's one of the best reasons to do it, because if you can't have fun hacking games, why do it? And a lot of people do it for profit. And then a lot of people do it for the lulz and the profit. Typically, this is the way I started out. Your typical adversary can be a researcher, like the little kid taking apart a toaster to see how it works. That's pretty much how I started out. I started taking apart game clients to learn how the protocols work and all that stuff. And they're interested in things like, can they bypass client-side checks? What kind of encryption is being used? What kind of third-party libraries are being used? You know, can they plainly view the sound and art files? And you know, how does the protocol work? And how do they validate low-level inputs that are passed on this protocol? A lot of these guys will find exploits by accident. I noticed that it's super common, as you're playing with a protocol, that it's super common to crash a server. It's a bad thing to do, because then it's pretty noisy. Like, there's probably a crash log that's associated with your session ID and your account. So when I'm attacking online games, I try to be very careful at what I do, because these things are super fragile and the tiniest little change can crash them. I've crashed servers in very interesting ways. Some of them, I caused them to go down for like half a day, and I didn't mean to. Like, it was just an accident. I was just playing around. Then you have your cheaters and hackers. They reverse engineer the client specifically for modifying gameplay behavior. They either modify the client runtime while it's in memory and executing, or statically they modify it so that it can persist and they can have the modification whenever they launch the client. Typically, they do it to gain advantage over players. As you can see here, this is Counter-Strike Go. And it's a common hack to use a wall hack where you can basically see players hiding behind obstacles, and it gives them a huge advantage over other players. These types of hacks are very disruptive. If you've ever been 360 no-scoped, you know what I'm talking about. It's basically sometimes people use bots to basically shoot people around you, and the bot will aim, do a headshot every single time. Doesn't matter where you are on the map, you know, they'll spin around and kill you instantly. It's not for a very conducive online gaming experience. Then you have your professional hackers that do it for profit. They're after the in-game commodities. By the way, this little graph that's like firing off by the side, it's pretty cool. It's basically a visualizer for inter-module calls. So you can see which calls an application is making to outside libraries. It's a useful high-level tool to determine what libraries are being used, but I just thought it looked cool, so that's why I threw it in there. It's not really useful for what we're going to be doing, and I'll show you why, but a lot of the time, professional hackers use custom tools or off-the-shelf tools or a combination of both. If you use off-the-shelf tools, it'll get detected by cheat detection engines pretty quickly because they have common signatures and certain behavior that's common and easily detected, so they'll modify off-the-shelf tools to kind of go under the radar. And the professional hackers are after ODAs. typically, they're not after server compromise. You know, the traditional way of gaining root on the server is not what they're really looking for. I've seen that done in the past. A lot of the Chinese players, typically, they don't care about laws or anything like that. So they'll go in, get root on the server, and dump the database of players. And I've seen in an instance where in Guild Wars 2, they were able to get 2 million player accounts, and they were selling them on the black market for like $5 a pop. And they'd use these hacked accounts to advertise their in-game services, like in-game websites that sell currencies and stuff like that. and professional hackers are very active in evading countermeasures, especially these days. There's a lot of countermeasures that detect client modification or high-level statistics. Like if you're a player in-game and you're level one and you have like 10 gold, and then an hour later you have suddenly a million gold, you know, something was going on there. So they have to be careful with high-level statistics in order to evade detection. And then you have nation states. This is kind of surprising to me. And it was kind of scary too, because this when this came out, this was back in 2011, I was still in this business of hacking online games for profit. And I was like, hey, this guy, Kim Jong-il or whatever, is one of my competitors. I was like, this is interesting. so there was a case where 30 North Korean operatives were found in South Korea, and they were botting and farming in a game called Lineage 2. And Lineage 2 is highly popular in South Korea, and they were making a pretty good income off of it. I think they made $6 million under a year using black market virtual currency trading and hacks. Then there's also a case where people use Chinese prisoners. There's been cases where prisoners are forced to farm World of Warcraft gold. There was one case where 300 prisoners were playing World of Warcraft 12 hours a day, and they were generating $800 a day for whoever was forcing them, the warden or the corrupt prison officials or whatever. So, I mean, anywhere you have money to be made, there's going to be corruption and foul play. Chinese farmers, there's over 100,000 active farmers, and there's probably more than that. Typically, they are bot assisted, or either they do it manually, they play the game manually, like kind of like the Chinese prisoners. They work in sweatshop-like conditions, and their activities are harmful to gameplay. Sometimes you can play an online game and you'll see a scarce resource pop up on the edge of the map. Let's say like a treasure chest, that's an epic treasure chest or whatever. You start running towards it, and then you have like 30 people pop in from nowhere and try it and just basically steal it from you and move on. So like spawn camping and resource sniping is kind of a harmful thing to legit game players, because the Chinese farmers are really good at knowing where all the best spots in the game are to get the best loot, and they'll kind of crowd everybody else out of it. So it's a harmful thing for gameplay, and it's not a fun thing for anybody. All right, but hacking for profit, let's go back to that. So what does $1 million look like in US currency? It looks like that, big old pile of $100 bills, and it weighs about 22 pounds. What does $1 million look like in Elder Scrolls currency? It's about 8 bytes, And if you added up all those electrons that make up those 8 bytes, it's a billionth of a gram. It's a lot easier to have $1 million in virtual currency than it is in real life. 1 million, I pulled this up last weekend, and the market price for 1 million Elder Scrolls Online gold was about $77. So if we do the math, to have $1 million USD worth of ESO gold, you'd need about 13,000-ish million units of ESO gold, which is about 12 billion gold. And Elder Scrolls Online equals $1 million in US. That seems like a lot of gold, but as you guys saw in WildStar, it's pretty easy to get. So manually, if you try to get 12 billion gold in the game, it would probably be impossible and take you forever. But if you're hacking, it's pretty easy. This is another example where I used an integer overflow in the auction house. And in a single mail message, I was able to send myself 4.2 billion gold. So having $1 million in game is about the same as having three mail messages with 4.2 billion gold. This would take about a month to pull off. But remember WildStar. WildStar gold sells for about $5 per million units. So we had 9 quintillion gold, do some math, and it turns out the market cap of that account was about 45 trillion US dollars. So I don't know if the Fed takes WildStar gold, but it could definitely help towards lowering the deficit. So challenges in hacking online games. Early on, there really weren't any countermeasures. You could do anything you wanted willy-nilly. It was kind of like the Wild West. Now there's a lot of countermeasures, and there's some pretty advanced stuff coming out there. Things like proprietary encryption, anti-debugging methods, packet integrity checks, packet sequencing, server-side statistics, fingerprinting the client and host installation. And the latest one that's really advanced is code flow obfuscation. The clients either self-encrypt the code paths or they modify their code at runtime. So it really hurts in debugging and reverse engineering efforts. So advanced countermeasures help adversaries. You're basically building a bubble around your game and you're saying, nobody can hack this game except advanced adversaries. So the guys that really know their stuff will have dibs on the low-hanging fruit exploits, because those low-hanging fruit exploits are out of reach of the casual hackers because of these advanced countermeasures. So I've noticed that the more countermeasures a client has, the more likely it is that I'll find a lot of good exploits. So a typical game client kind of looks like this. This is a kind of a logical layout. You basically have a lot of interactions like login, move, trade, attack, and chat message. And these events fire off typically a sequence of events that causes the message to be dispatched, encrypted, and sent out to network. And when you're attacking these clients, the best place to basically start modifying data is right here where everything kind of funnels in together. You can start accessing the core data that makes up all these transactions and more. Or you could do it down there, it doesn't matter. The thing about the funnel approach or finding the where the funnel ends in this is like, you can start enumerating functionality. It's obvious that there's, you know, functionality like logging in, moving, trading, attacking, and chat message. If you like to name out all the possible interactions you could have with a client, you could probably name out maybe a dozen or two. But most games have about 300 to 400 different messages they send out to the network. So if you do it manually, you're missing the whole big picture. You're only attacking, you know, 10% of the attack surface. So if you catch the data going at the funnel, you'll be able to discover a lot more functionality that you're going to be able to exploit. I'll kind of skip over this. This is so we had a case where a game was using runtime code obfuscation, and they were employing a lot of anti-debugging tricks. So we had to build a new tool to basically analyze the binary at runtime while bypassing all these different countermeasures. I'll kind of show you a video of how that worked. So this is a path of exile, and anytime you start attacking a game, you want to find out that where that funnel ends and where the data gets encrypted. So we created a quick little tool to help us identify where functionality in the game is flowing in order to identify that choke point where all other data flows. So here I am playing around in Path of Exile. I'll say a little hello message in chat, whatever, run around. So this tool, once it's initialized, it will identify any function in the game that handles data of interest. And it doesn't matter if this function is encrypted or obfuscated, or if there's control flow obfuscation routines going on. This method we created will completely bypass all that and show what's truly going on. So I'm going to fire it off, and I'll set it to look at the executable itself, Path of Exile, and nothing else. So now it's fired off, and now it's watching the game for wherever it's going to execute that chat message. And it quickly spits out a bunch of functions that were handling that chat message. And you can go through line by line, kind of inspect what's going on and get a feel for the data flow. And you do this on several different types of functionality to kind of get an idea of what's going on. In this case, the chat functionality was handled by 290 different functions. And you can kind of dive in and see exactly what's going on, where they were in, where they were passed in as arguments, and sections of code that handled this chat functionality. So kind of using that, you're able to find the funnel choke point, and then you create, there's another tool we use to basically modify the client to intercept all outgoing packets. So this is basically how, for the past 20 years, we've been hacking online games, is using this tool to monitor, modify, and basically fuzz different types of packets to explore functionality and make the packets exploit the APIs in the way they were meant to be used. So I just want to kind of show you that these custom tools in the background are being used by advanced adversaries, and any advanced countermeasures that are in the client are going to be bypassed, and everybody's going to have access to the core protocol, and they're going to be able to fuzz any data that's going out to the server to mess with your internal business logic and other crazy stuff. So, summary, here's a screenshot of Final Fantasy 14. It's another integer overflow where we were able to get 2 billion potions. Each potion was like 10 gold each, so it was like $20 billion on a single stack of potions. Typically, the game only allows you, if you're to play legitimately, it only allows you to have like a stack of 100. So, we have a stack of 2 billion potions, which is worth a lot of gold. But to summarize, extreme obfuscation works in favor of highly skilled hackers. The low-hanging fruit exploits are protected. Typically, integer over and underflow exploits are very prevalent. So you want to make sure to monitor exactly where your financial transactions are happening, and you want to make sure that you're testing for integer overflows and underflows. There's a lot of people going after online games because there's a lot of money to be made, so expect to be probed and hacked. Use audit logs. Raise red flags when there's unusual events. Like if you have a level one character that suddenly has 2 billion gold, that's probably not normal. And also, when designing these online games, you have to take a holistic approach to security. You have to really focus on the client, the server, especially the server and what's going on in the background. Basically assume the client is compromised and untrusted. Security through obscurity doesn't work. There's been a lot of cases where clients try to obscure their code flows and everything. It just doesn't really work. Again, going back to integer overflows, compilers try to warn you about these. Don't ignore compiler warnings when they warn you about integer overflows. I'm stuck around integer overflows because there's been probably over 100 of them in, you know, these 20 plus games. Any questions about anything? Yeah.
So when you're attaching a debugger to one of these online games, like through the client, do you not ever experience a case where the game will crash or shut down because you have interrupted the connection between the client and the server for a significant amount of time?
Yeah, that's an awesome question. Typically, games timeout, some of them are pretty lax. They'll set the protocol to timeout maybe after 5 seconds or so. There's been games where they timeout after like half a second. In those games, you really can't use a debugger. Or if you do, you have to be quick about it. But typically, we had to design the tool to basically replace the debugger to do runtime analysis of code flows. But yes, there's been at least a handful of games that are very time sensitive, and if you pause using a debugger for more than half a second, it'll kill the connection, and you know you'll get kicked back out to log, and you have to try again.
Okay, so you have to do something like automate it, where it will automatically just hit the debug point, then dump whatever you find, and
yeah,
then just keep going,
that's
right?
Another method too. You know, doing breakpoint logging. I use Ollie Debug.
Yeah.
It has a breakpoint logging functionality, and that's typically a good way to go about it.
Okay, thanks.
Hi, I enjoyed your presentation. Thank you. So I'm a software engineer. I have a fair amount of like debugger and assembly experience, but that's all been with like friendly executables that have symbols available.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you could recommend tools for investigating binaries that aren't doing anything to help you out.
So I mean, the king of the jungle is IDA Pro, the Interactive Disassembly Pro.
Okay.
Are you familiar with it?
I'm totally unfamiliar with this topic.
Okay, so just remember IDA Pro. That's it has a really good disassembler engine, and it also has a really good decompiler engine. A lot of the times, it can decompile a function into very readable C code or C++ code, and a lot of the times, you can copy that code into a compiler and compile it and run it locally and kind of play around with it. But IDA Pro is the king of the jungle right now.
Do you mind spelling that? I'm sorry, IDPRO?
IDAPRO. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Just a quick question. What have you seen with Fortnite? I know it's been targeted by, you know, a wide variety of Chinese. you've heard the stories,
right,
about what's happened with Fortnite, whether it's on mobile or whether it's on another system. What have you seen in that space? You're talking about conventional MMORPGs. What about more like
FPS.
FPS, right. Games, online FPS games, you know, how, this is more of a generalized question,
yeah.
But how are the methods similar or different for doing security investigations?
They use very similar methods to hack the clients and reverse engineer the clients. Typically, I never target the FPS games because they don't really have virtual currencies or goods that you can trade with other players, so there's not a lot of profit to be made there. But I've seen services by Russian hackers and some Chinese where they reverse engineer the client and they provide things like wall hacks or radar hacks where you can see other players in the game and stuff like that. Speed hacks where you're able to run faster than another player and things like that. And they sell these hacks as a service. Like You pay them like $20 a month, and you can run a hack on like PUBG or whatever to have like a radar map or whatever. So anywhere where you can gain advantage over another player, you can package that up as an executable, as a hack, and then sell it to anybody that's interested to gain an advantage over other players.
Okay, thank you.
You talked about disclosing before the... Do any of the game companies offer like bug bounties or anything like that if you wanted to be a little bit lighter colored hat or...
Typically, so when I first started out, I tried to disclose, like back in the late 90s, early 2000s, I tried to disclose these exploits to the game companies, and the response typically was like to ban my account and told me to never come back. They're like, do not reverse engineer a game, you're violating the terms of service and the EULA or whatever. And they just outright banned me. So I was like, okay, if you want to play...
They're like years back.
Behind everybody else.
Right, yeah, so, right. And it's still the case.
So they hit you with the lawyer wall instead of accepting your research.
Trying to disclose a bug to a game company is typically a negative experience.
Okay.
Yeah, it's way easier to turn around and make it into a profitable business on the side than it is to disclose to a game company. Okay, we're out of time, so I'll wrap up. Good. All right. Thank you very much.